and just go ahead and come up and get things started. Good evening, everybody. It's good to see you. Thanks for being here at the end of what's been a really good day. I know that some people are sore. We had work day this morning, and then Bob's not sore. He's shaking his head over there, you know, so you got to come to work day to get sore, I guess. So, then we also had the coat giveaway with Life Four Corners, and that was a great success. So thank you, everybody who was able, and those who weren't able, it's okay. There will be another, there will be other opportunities. You're welcome back the next time. But let's go ahead and get started tonight. If you would stand, if you've got your Bible and you want to read along, I'm going to be reading a long passage tonight because I just don't want to break it up. So we're going to start tonight in Hebrews chapter 10, starting in verse 37, and then we're going to go all the way through to the first two verses of Hebrews chapter 12. It says, "Yet a little while and the coming one will come and will not delay. But my righteous one shall live by faith, and if he shrinks back, my soul has no pleasure in him. But we are not of those who shrink back and are destroyed, but of those who have faith and preserve their souls. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it the people of old received their commendation. By faith we understand that the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible. By faith, Abel offered to God a more acceptable sacrifice than Cain, through which he was commended as righteous, God commending him by accepting his gifts. And through his faith, though he died, he still speaks. By faith, Enoch was taken up so that he should not see death, and he was not found because God had taken him. Now, before he was taken, he was commended as having pleased God. And without faith, it is impossible to please God. For whoever would draw near to God must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who seek him. By faith, Noah, being warned by God concerning events as yet unseen, in reverent fear constructed an ark for the saving of his household. By this he condemned the world and became an heir of the righteousness that comes by faith. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to a place that he was to receive as an inheritance. And he went out, not knowing where he was going. By faith, he went to live in the land of promise as in a foreign land, living in tents with Isaac and Jacob, heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city that has foundations, whose designer and builder is God. By faith, Sarah herself received power to conceive, even when she was past the age, since she considered him faithful who had promised. Therefore, from one man, and him as good as dead, were born descendants as many as the stars of heaven and as many as the innumerable grains of the sand by the seashore." Now let's really hear this. "These all died in faith, not having received the things promised, but having seen them and greeted them from afar, and having acknowledged that they were strangers and exiles on the earth. For people who speak thus make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. If they had been thinking of the land from which they had gone out, they would have had opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country, that is a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared for them a city. By faith, Abraham, when he was tested, offered up Isaac, and he who had received the promises was in the act of offering up his only son, of whom it was said, 'Through Isaac shall your offspring be named.' He considered that God was able to even raise him from the dead, from which, figuratively speaking, he did receive him back. By faith, Isaac invoked future blessings on Jacob and Esau. By faith, Jacob, when dying, blessed each of the sons of Joseph, bowing in worship over the head of his staff. By faith, Joseph, at the end of his life, made mention of the exodus of the Israelites and gave directions concerning his bones. By faith, Moses, when he was born, was hidden for 3 months by his parents because they saw that the child was beautiful, and they were not afraid of the king's edict. By faith, Moses, when he was grown up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to be mistreated with the people of God than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. He considered the reproach of Christ greater wealth than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking to the reward. By faith, he left Egypt, not being afraid of the anger of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. By faith, he kept the Passover and sprinkled the blood so that the destroyer of the firstborn might not touch them. By faith, the people crossed the Red Sea as on dry land, but the Egyptians, when they attempted to do the same, were drowned.
By faith, the walls of Jericho fell down after they had been encircled for 7 days. By faith, Rahab the prostitute did not perish with those who were disobedient, because she had given a friendly welcome to the spies. And what more shall I say? For time would fail me to tell of Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, of David and Samuel and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, enforced justice, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions, quenched the power of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, were made strong out of weakness, became mighty in war, put our foreign armies to flight. Women received back their dead by resurrection. Some were tortured, refusing to accept release, so that they might rise again to a better life. Others suffered mocking and flogging and even chains and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn in two, they were killed with the sword. They went about in skins of sheep and goats, destitute, afflicted, mistreated, of whom the world was not worthy, wandering about in deserts and mountains and in dens and caves of the earth. And all these, though commended through their faith, did not receive what was promised, since God had provided something better for us, that apart from us, they should not be made perfect. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. The word of the Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Let us sing to the Lord. Come, let us bow down before him. His banner is love over us. His mercies are new every morning. High within our hearts, high within our minds, Jesus, you alone, our rock, our cornerstone. High within our hearts, high within our minds. Come, let us sing to the Lord. Come, let us bow down before him. His banner is love over us. His mercies are new every morning. So we lift you high, forever lift you high, high within our hearts, high within our minds, Jesus, you alone, our rock, our cornerstone, high within our hearts, high within our minds. So we lift you high, forever lift you high, high within our hearts, high within our minds. Jesus, you alone, our rock, our cornerstone, high within our hearts, high within our lives. Yes, Jesus. Oh, I won't let the rocks cry out in my place. We return the breath you gave with our praise. I won't let the rocks cry out in my place. We return the breath you gave with our praise. So we lift you high. Forever lift you high, high within our hearts, high within our minds. Jesus, you alone, our rock, our cornerstone, high within our hearts, high within our soul. So we lift you high, forever lift you high. High within our hearts, high within our minds. Jesus, you alone, our rock, our cornerstone. High within our hearts, high within our minds. Let everything that's in me bless his holy name. Everything that's in me bless his holy name. Everything that's in me, bless his holy name. Everything, all I have, all I bring, everything that's in me, bless his holy name. So we lift you high. So we lift you high, forever lift you high, high within our hearts, high within our minds. Jesus, you alone, our rock, our cornerstone, high within our hearts, high within our minds. So we lift you high. Forever lift you high, high within our hearts, high within our minds. Jesus, you alone, our rock, our cornerstone, high within our hearts, high within our minds. Everything that's in me, bless his holy name. Everything we bring, everything that's in me, bless his holy name. We worship everything. Everything that's in me, bless his holy name. Jesus,
King of kings and Lord of lords, you're the one we came here for, and we worship you. We worship you, King of kings and Lord of lords, you're the one our hearts adore, and we worship you. We worship you, King of kings and Lord of lords, you're the one we came here for, and we worship you. We worship you, King of kings and Lord of lords, you're the one our hearts adore, and we worship you. We worship you, King of kings and Lord of lords, you're the one we came here for, and we worship you. We worship you, King of kings and Lord of lords, you're the one our hearts adore, and we worship you. We worship you. And all of the glory and honor and power be unto your name, unto your name. And all of the glory and honor and power be unto your name, unto your name. And all of the glory and honor and power be unto your name, unto your name. And all of the glory and honor and power be unto your name, unto your name. King of kings and Lord of lords, you're the one we came here for, and we worship you. We worship you, King of kings and Lord of lords, you're the one our hearts adore, and we worship you. We worship you, King of kings and Lord of lords, you're the one we came here for, and we worship you. We worship you, King of kings and Lord of lords, you're the one our hearts adore, and we worship you. We worship you. And all of the glory and honor and power be unto your name, unto your name. All of the glory and honor and power be unto your name, unto your name. And all of the glory and honor and power be unto your name, unto your name. And all of the glory and honor and power be unto your name, unto your name.
One more time.
And all of the glory and honor and power be unto your name, unto your name. And all of the glory and honor and power be unto your name, unto your name. And all of the glory and honor and power, and all of the glory and honor and power, and all of the glory and honor and power, and all of the glory and honor and power, and all of the glory and honor and power, and all of the glory and honor and power, and all of the glory and honor and power be unto your name, unto your name. Lord of lords, you're the one we came here for, and we worship you. We worship you, King of kings and Lord of lords, you're the one our hearts adore, and we worship you. We worship you, and all of the glory and honor and power be unto your name, unto your name. All of the glory and honor and power be unto your name, unto your name. And all of the glory and honor and power, and all of the glory and honor and power, and all of the glory and honor and power be unto your name, unto your name.
Hallelujah. Worthy, 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 worthy.
My help comes from the Lord. My help comes
comes from the Lord. My help comes from the Lord. My help comes from the Lord. My help comes from the Lord. You're the only one I'm looking for. 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 And I was made by you. And I was made for you. And I am unfulfilled without full communion. And I was made by you. And I was made for you. And I am unfulfilled without full until I look like the one I behold. And I pour out my vial until all of me is on the floor. And at your feet I will sing. And at your feet I will sing. Your name is sweet like honey. Your voice, it sounds like the waters. Your eyes are full of fire, fairer than the sons of men. Your name is pure and holy. For you alone are worthy. There is none beside you, Lord of lords and King of kings. And I will stay here for a little while until I look like the one I behold. And I will pour out my vial until all of me is on the floor. And at your feet I will sing. And at your feet I will sing. At your feet. And at your feet I will sing. And at your feet I will sing. Your name is sweet like honey. Your voice, it sounds like the waters. Your eyes are full of fire, fairer than the sons of men. Your name is pure and holy. For you alone are worthy. There is none beside you,
and King of Kings. Your name is sweet like honey. Your voice, it sounds like the waters. Your eyes are full of fire, fairer than the sons of men. Your name is pure and holy. For you alone are worthy. There is none beside you, Lord of lords and King of kings. There is none beside you, Lord of lords and King of kings. I give you all my worship. I give you all my worship. I give you all my worship. For you alone are God. I give you all my worship. I give you all my worship. I give you all my worship. For you alone are God. I give you all my worship. I give you all my worship. I give you all my worship. For you alone are God. And I stay here for a little while, until I look like the one I behold. And I pour out my vial, until all of me is on the floor. And at your feet I will sing. At your feet I will sing. Your name is sweet like honey. Your voice, it sounds like the waters. Your eyes are full of fire, fairer than the sons of men. Your name is pure and holy, for you alone are worthy. There is none beside you, Lord of lords and King of kings. There is none beside you, Lord of lords and King of kings. There is none beside you, Lord of lords and King of kings.
Thank you, Lord. We are right now almost halfway through the Feast of Tabernacles, where Israel celebrates every year God's provision, his protection, how he led them through the wilderness for 40 years. John chapter 7 tells us about Jesus going to Jerusalem to celebrate the Feast of Tabernacles. And in verse 37 it says, on the last day of the feast, the great day, Jesus stood up and cried out, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. Now this he said about the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were to receive, for as yet the Spirit had not been given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. We just sang tonight that we were created by Jesus, but also that we were created for Jesus. I think what we see in Jesus' words at the Feast of Tabernacles is that he created us with a longing that can't be filled outside of him. He created us to thirst and be filled, to hunger and to be satisfied. And so tonight, let's just pray. And number one, thank God that he satisfies our soul, that he has given us himself. But let's also pray for all those who are unsatisfied, all those who only know the thirst and have never had it quenched by his Spirit.
And during this Feast of Tabernacles, let's pray especially for Israel, that this thirst that was created in them as God's people would be filled by Jesus, the Messiah, and the Spirit who's been promised. Father, thank you today that you didn't simply create us for you because there were tasks to be done. Being created for you is not about the mission, the purpose, all the things we make it, because those things are so temporary. But we were created for fellowship with you. We were created for relationship with you. We were created for eternity with you, which Jesus himself said is knowing him and knowing the Father who sent him. And so tonight, God, I pray for all of our unsatisfied places, for all of those places where we're thirsty and we're hungry and we are chasing and grabbing and pleading and believing that if this would just happen, we'd finally be at peace. May we know and believe tonight that we were created to thirst and we were created to hunger, and we will never be satisfied until all of our thirst is quenched in you, until all of our hunger is filled by you, the bread of life, by the Holy Spirit, that living water that comes into us and flows out of us. And so tonight, God, show us all of those unsatisfied places, and may we yield them to you. Thank you that you did not create us to stay unsatisfied, but you created us to find all of our hope and all of our joy, all of our peace in you. Thank you that you are our peace. Thank you that your joy is our strength. Thank you that you are our hope, our anchor of our soul. Thank you that you are love, and in you there is no shadow of turning. So your love doesn't fade. Your love doesn't shrink. Your love doesn't turn. Your love remains. And so tonight, God, I pray that we would be a people who dwell in you the way that you desire to dwell in us. May we be a people who say, come, Holy Spirit, and not praying that a service would go a certain way or we'd get a certain feeling, but that your Spirit would come and dwell in us, and we would learn how to dwell in him, that we would put our ear to God's heart and leave it there, that we would be a people who don't just have the mind of Christ, but who think on him, who desire and feast on him. So tonight, God, thank you that when all the things that we list that we need, you have given us yourself. And you have given us yourself in an abundant, overflowing, never-ending measure. And God, as your people, we stand here tonight and we pray for all of those who are thirsty. But we pray tonight, especially during this Feast of Tabernacles for Israel. God, we pray that your people would hunger for you. We pray that your people would not just look back and remember the manna, but they would look upon the one who was pierced, that they would look upon the one who was wounded, the one who has died and who lives and who is coming yet again. Save your people, God. Meet the desire of their souls. Meet that thirsty, hungry place with yourself. May you even tonight stir as they remember the manna. May they know Jesus, the bread of life. As they remember the tabernacle, may they know the heavenly tabernacle and the one who allowed himself to be torn so that we may come into the holy places. As they remember the wilderness, may they know the Spirit who guides us into all truth. May they know Jesus, the author and the finisher of all faith. Thank you for loving us enough to give yourself, not for us, but to us. Thank you that you do not deny this one request, that we would ask for your Spirit to come and dwell in us. Thank you that you alone are worthy. You alone are worthy. And yet you pour your valuable self upon us. Thank you that Mary poured out her vial on your feet, but you have poured out your Spirit upon your people.
Thank you.
May we abound in you.
Thank you.
May we abound in you. And all those things that we're still waiting on, may we know in the depths of our heart that none of them compare. None of them compare
to the one who has given us himself. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We come to you thirsty, knowing that you don't give us to drink. You become the drink that quenches our souls. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you guys. You can be seated.
As you're being seated, Anthony is going to be coming tonight to lead us in our intercession. Anthony, thank you.
Hello, everyone. So, sorry, this mic has been giving us some problems tonight. Hold it, and hopefully that helps. Sorry. So a couple weeks ago, I got this little newsletter from the Moody Bible Institute, and it was specifically speaking about the Mormon Church. And I had brought it to Joanne's attention and said, I really feel like this is something that we should pray for. And she said, okay. And then not so long after that, she said, the Holy Spirit told me that it should be you. So my first instinct was to say no, just because it's a little nerve-wracking. But then I realized that my comfort is not important, but the salvation of these people is. So I'm just going to read a couple of the little facts in here that I didn't know before we pray. So this is about a gentleman named Bradley Campbell, who graduated in 2017 from the Moody Bible Institute. And he actually said, describing the state of Utah is like depicting a nation in the Middle East. Utah would be considered an unreached people group if it were overseas. Utah is the only state in the entire country that has never been predominantly Christian, the only one. Utah has the lowest percentage of Christians in the country by far, yet it is the most religious state in the country by far. And that spoke to me on a couple of different reasons, mostly because Mormons, they do believe in Christ. So it is easy to sweep them into the category of Christians, but not going to get up into that. But there is some belief that they are not. No matter what, they do believe in Christ. And I believe they believe incorrectly. And I think it was in Galatians, Paul had mentioned correcting believers that were following the wrong path. So I think it's important for us to pray for them, for their salvation, that they would know Jesus rightly. Knowing Jesus is just the first step into salvation. Knowing Jesus rightly, I think it's overlooked sometimes. So I'd like for us to pray for those that are missionaries in Utah. When we think of missionaries, I know I often think of foreign countries overseas, you know, in Asia and Africa and South America. I don't think of the United States. But when we have an entire state that has such a small population of people who truly believe in Jesus rightly, and yet they're still considered the most religious state, I feel like there's an opening there. But I also think we need to pray for patience and perseverance for those that are sharing the gospel, just so that they don't give up. You know, it's hard to go to a people group and say, like, you know, you need Jesus in your life. And if they don't know Jesus, that's great. But I think with the Mormons knowing Jesus in a way, they're going to hold back a little. So I think we should pray for that, for grace and for patience and perseverance for the missionaries, and then ultimately for the salvation of Mormons turning to Jesus truthfully, and really just giving their lives to him in a beautiful way that is meant for all of us. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, first and foremost, I want to thank you that we have this beautiful ability to pray for others. That intercessory prayer is something that we share with you, Jesus. That no matter how far away these people might be, if they're on the other side of the globe or just a few hundred thousand, well, I guess they're just a couple thousand miles away from us here, but that we can pray and make a difference, that we don't necessarily have to be boots on the ground to make a difference in your kingdom. I pray for the missionaries, first and foremost, that they would continue to not ignore these people. We often pray for people who don't know you at all. And I thank you for their dedication to continue to pray for and with people who know you in a confused way. I pray that you would open eyes. I pray that you would just open ears and hearts, that so many people, such a large group of people, would just come to know you and know you rightly, and then continue to share that within their circles, within the people they knew and deal with on a daily basis. Habakkuk 2:14 says, as the glory of the Lord would be known as the waters cover the sea. I've just butchered that, but I pray that this would be a moment for headway to be made. That entire groups of people, whether they're on the other side of the planet or just a few states away, that they would come to know the truth and the power and the light of Jesus, that they would know him well and they would know him rightly, that there would be no false doctrines, that there would be no confusion. And I pray for those missionaries that you have placed there, that they will be in the right place at the right time to answer the questions for people who are fearful. No matter where you are, no matter what you believe, it is hard to believe something different than your neighbors. And I pray that you give the Mormon people who are willing to make a change the strength to do that, that you would bolster their hearts, give them the strength they need to walk away from things that they've been taught their entire life. And I thank you, Lord, because I know that you will be there when they're ready and willing to turn to you. I know that you will be right there with open arms. So I thank you tonight, Jesus. I thank you for who you are and what you've done. And I pray that we have this opportunity to come sit with you and pray for everybody to come to know your name, Lord. Just pray all these things in your beautiful, precious name, Jesus. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Anthony. Couple of announcements that I just want to share with you tonight. First of all, I said it at the beginning, but I just want to thank everyone that was able to come out for work day today. We actually had a good time today, right, Tom? Like it was fun. My back feels it a little bit, but and then those that have decided to start coming an hour before it starts so that you get the credit for all of the work that actually gets done. Thank you guys. But as I mentioned, over the last couple of weeks, our work crew that goes in and does all the framing and all the real work, decided to knock down a block wall. And so today we decided to get the block wall out of there. And so Paul borrowed a dump truck and we loaded up the dump truck and got a lot of other things done. So thank you guys, all of you who come out. And just a reminder, the third Saturday of every month, can always use hands to work. Barb was there today, cleaned the stairwell beautifully, even though I thought it was someone else that did it. Barb, thank you. It was very well done, and just always a good time with the brothers and the sisters. So again, mark your calendars the third Saturday of every month. And then just the one announcement I want to make for you is this coming Friday night is our annual bonfire that the Shell Hearts host for us. There was an email sent out earlier this week for RSVP, and that gives me a great opportunity to segue into one other announcement then. If we don't have your email, if you're not getting emails from us, that's how most of our information is shared. Some through Facebook and Instagram, but most of it through email. If you want to get on the email list, there is a card on the table out there. It's called a Connect card. Just fill that out with your address if you want us to have it, but also especially your email address, and we will get you on there this week. But an email went out for an email RSVP. If you plan on coming, you're welcome to come. Bring your family. It's always a good time. It's always a lot of fun. I am going to go ahead and put the worship team on the spot now. We're going to have some worship. We will have s'mores. We will have hot dogs. We will have apple cider donuts. Most of all, we're going to have some really good fellowship. So Paul and Barb, thank you again for hosting and for just always being so generous with us. So that's all the announcements that I'm going to share with you tonight. So why don't we take a couple minutes, greet each other, introduce yourself to somebody if you see a new face. And when we come back in just a couple minutes, we're going to have the privilege of having Jonathan share God's word with us tonight. So thank you guys.
Well, guys, it's good to have you here. Good to see you enjoying each other. As you head back to your seats, tonight we, you know, you guys realize we're coming up to the end of Hebrews, right? Like we started Hebrews first Saturday in February, and I promised we would get through it at the end of November, and I think we're actually going to make it. Part of us making it is me letting other people preach, so I don't slow it down so much, so I don't get caught up in a verse for weeks upon weeks, right? But part of what I've loved about going through Hebrews together this year has been hearing from so many of our preachers, and we have so many preachers that we always have people preaching on a regular basis, which is so good for me. But it's good for all of us. But, you know, often it's, you know, whatever's on somebody's heart or whatever God's been speaking. But the fact that we all committed to, we're going to go through Hebrews together and we're going to go through it verse by verse. And wherever my opportunity comes, I'm God's going to work it out. And so to be able to do that together has been such a blessing. And I'm not going to name names because I'll forget somebody and then I'll feel terrible all week.
But there's been a lot on the Cornelius plate with the kids and moving and work and everything else. And so I have been praying that we would get Jonathan in here and ready and willing and able to preach before Hebrews finished. And so thank God tonight's the night. So Jonathan, thank you. Have your way. I said it on Facebook. I'll say it again. I have like a handful of favorite preachers, and somehow we all get to share the same room together, which is a huge blessing to me. But you are in that handful, and so I'm excited to hear what God has to say through you tonight. So thanks for being willing, Jonathan.
Hey, good evening. Can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you for that, Ivy. If you guys want to thank someone as well, you can thank Amber, because she was like, I can see you doing this. You need to do this. I think you should do this. You should do this. So thank you, Amber. It's good to be with you guys. Thanks again for the opportunity to be up here. It's been a while to share. So we're going to talk about a little bit about Hebrews 11. Maybe might have to do some sweeping up a little bit, but I think God will carry us through. So let's pray. Lord, thank you that you are the better thing.
Yeah.
And you enjoy revealing that to us. So I pray that this would be another moment of you just doing that, that you reveal yourself to us as the better. No matter what it is, fill in the blank, you are the better. So I pray that we would speak through this message to each and every one of our hearts, that you are willing, that you are able, that you are open, and that you are better. Amen. All right, so Hebrews 11. It was really hard, I have to admit, to write this sermon without having some repetition from the last few sermons that was spoken. And I tried really hard to get away from that. And the harder I tried, the harder it got to write this sermon. So if you hear a lot of repeated themes, maybe God's trying to tell you something, tell us something. So I couldn't help but come back to the theme of endurance again and again and again. And it hit me that the purpose of highlighting, the Hall of Faith, as it's known in chapter 11, that's the list of saints of old that chapter 11 talks about, was to highlight their endurance. But even more than that, it was to highlight what they were enduring for. And so it's really easy to get caught up in this chapter and become preoccupied with all the well-known names listed in this chapter, all the stories that comes along with those names, that's associated with those names. But what I've been reminded of, and hopefully you guys are being reminded of too, when it comes to reading the book of Hebrews as slowly as we have been doing, is that those names are listed in this chapter to highlight the name above all names, first and foremost. And in fact, the whole book of Hebrews was written, towards the theme that we have been emphasizing all year, and that is Jesus is better. So Hebrews was written to Jewish believers who were becoming discouraged. They were in danger of falling away, going back to the shadow rather than staying with the substance. And what this section of scripture, this section of Hebrews chapter 11 is doing, it is calling these Jewish believers to continue the course of endurance just as God's people did throughout the ages. And it has to be that ultimately What these saints of old were enduring for was the promises fulfilled in Christ Jesus. And so that's what we're going to talk about here. I'm going to be all over the place, but I really want to focus on the last two verses of chapter 11. And that's verses 39 and 40. And it says that all these, that's speaking of all the saints, all these, though commended through their faith, did not receive what was promised. Since God had provided something better for us, that apart from us, they should not be made perfect. What does that mean? That's an odd verse. It's a really odd verse. The Complete Jewish Bible states it this way. I to me, it drove the point home even more for me. All of these had their merit attested because of their trust in. Nevertheless, they did not receive what was promised because God had planned something better that would involve us, so that only with us they would be brought to the goal. What is the goal? What does the writer mean when he says they should not be made perfect apart from us? And yes, that us includes us today. It includes all believers of Christ that have lived from back then all the way until now, until all the way until when Christ returns, whenever he returns. Heroes of, think about this, right? Just think about this. Heroes of the faith, like Moses, Elijah, Daniel, Esther, Ruth, throw a name in there, just whatever name. They will not be made perfect without us. Have you ever thought about that? Because that's what he's saying. What does that mean? My hope is that in speaking about this, we would be encouraged in the same way the Holy Spirit wanted to encourage those Jewish believers that this letter was written to. So, like many of us who have read this chapter before, the only thing that used to stand out to me about this chapter was the list of names listed here. Right, the heroes of faith, or the Hall of Faith list, and the definition of faith, right? The definition of faith in the first few chapters. Faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Those are the only things that used to, that's the only thing that chapter 11 was good for, for me. And for a wide plethora of, Christians today. But in this slow, intentional reading of Hebrews, there have been some repeated themes that have stood out to me. First, this section of Hebrews is continuing the call, like I said, to endure, right? That theme kind of started to be emphasized in the previous chapter, chapter 10, verse 32, where AB preached from 2 weeks ago. And it's continuing along that same thought for believers who were being persecuted and suffering, and who initially were enduring those struggles joyfully, right? And so the writer of Hebrews is doing, what the writer of Hebrews is doing is, as you read on to chapter 11, he's showing his audience that in the same way they were experiencing persecution, suffering, and joyfully accepting being made spectacles of for the sake of Christ, that is the same way that in the former days, the saints of old, throughout all of biblical history, were being made to be persecuted. And they were commended by God for doing so. So let me read the verses, chapter 10, verses 32 through 36. It says, "Recall the former days when after you were enlightened, You endured a hard struggle with sufferings, sometimes being publicly exposed to reproach and affliction, and sometimes being partners with those so treated. For you had compassion on those in prison, and you joyfully accepted the plundering of your property, since you knew that you yourselves had a better possession and an abiding one. Keep a note there, highlight that if you can. Therefore, do not throw away your confidence, which has a great reward. For you have need of endurance, so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what is promised. I want you to notice the themes here. Believers are enduring being persecuted, joyfully accepting the plunder of their property, their earthly possessions. And they knew they had a better / abiding reward. Now in chapter 11, read chapter 11 in light of those themes, because that's what it's talking about. It's flushing that out. And now here's one example. Here's one example of what I'm talking about, because what you'll see is the saints of old, the list that you read, those heroes of the faith endured in the same manner. And here's one example in chapter 11, verse 24, speaking of Moses. It says, by faith, Moses, when he was grown up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to be mistreated with the people of God than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. Listen to this. He considered the reproach of Christ greater wealth than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking to the reward. Chapter 11 is not about separate stories of past saints fulfilling their destinies or fulfilling their dreams, and God just happened to be, hey, I'll help you out with that. Sometimes we talk about chapter 11 like that. Me and AB have talked about this before. I share his disdain for the word destiny and the way how it's been used by a lot of Christianity today. The writer of Hebrews is invoking those saints of old to call his audience back to the endurance they were displaying in the first place. The writer is referencing those heroes to say, you were on the right track. You were following what followers of God was always commended for doing. Keep going. But here's also what might be the mysterious part. And we read it before. The writer was also pointed out to his audience that the reward that those saints were looking for was not fully received by them. It's not my words, right? That's what the writer said twice in this chapter. And so let me read those verses. Starting at verse 13. It says, these all died in faith, not having received the things promised, but having seen them and greeted them from afar, having acknowledged that they were strangers and exiles on the earth. Verse 16, it says, but as it is, they desired a better country, that is, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared for them a city. This is the same thing that the writer commended his audience for in chapter 10. It's the same exact thing. And again, I'll read it again, chapter 11, verses 39 and 40. On all these, this again, he's talking about the same saints of old. Though commended through their faith, did not receive what was promised. since God had provided something better for us, that apart from us, they should not be made perfect. So what is the promise that the ancient saints saw and greeted from afar? What is the better possession? What is the abiding reward? What is the endurance and lasting possession that is mentioned in chapter 10? And I think the answer is hinted at in pretty stark terms in verse 26. I read it before, but I'll read it again. There's some repetition here, like I said. He, that is Moses, considered the reproach of Christ greater wealth than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking for the reward. The reproach of Christ was better wealth. You see that? How many of us would say, the reproach that I get for God, that's treasure, that's wealth. You know, when people laugh at me for saying I believe that Christ died and rose from the dead, that's wealth. If we're not laughed at by the world, then we're poor. That means it's Jesus, right? Jesus and the salvation that he won on our behalf is that abiding possession. It's Jesus and the reconciliation that he purchased with his blood. In Romans chapter 5, verses 6, it says, for while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Verse 8 through 11, it says, but God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Therefore, we have now been justified by his blood. Much more shall we be saved from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, I have to keep that in there. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more now that we are reconciled shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. This is the better possession. This is the promise. This is the reward. This is the heavenly city. What else would the writer mean by saying that the saints were seeing and greeting from afar? Jesus, when he was talking to the Pharisees in John chapter 5, verse 39, what did he say about the scriptures, the Hebrew scriptures? He said, you search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life. But it is they that bear witness of me. The Bible isn't just a book of good principles. It's about Christ. It was always about Christ from beginning to end. It's about Christ. Every story is about Christ. Every narrative is about Christ. It's not basic instructions before leaving earth. It's about Christ. It's not. So the writer here of Hebrews is redirecting his believer, is redirecting his fellow believers to stay the course toward that reward. And what should be encouraging to the Jewish believers that this letter was written to, and really what should be encouraging to us, is this: none of the listed people in chapter 11 had perfect endurance. None of them. They all faltered at some point. Most of us are familiar with their stories, and we know that some of them had really, really ugly parts of their stories, ugly parts of their lives, where there was little to no endurance. Just to skim past a few, Noah, We all know the story of Noah, where he built the ark. He witnessed the destruction of the world. It's not just a Sunday school cutesy story. He built the ark, and him and his family were the only survivors. That's not a Sunday school, rainbow, lovely birds chipping. You know, this isn't like Sesame Street, right? He witnessed the world be destroyed by water. And him and his family were the only survivors, right? After that, sometime later, he gets drunk. Something happened between him and his family members, and there's family strife. We see Abraham lying twice about his wife. We see Sarah, who heard a promise from God, that God said, this time next year, you will be with a child. And she laughed. She laughed. She laughed at God prophesying to her. Jacob swindled the birthright from his older brother and then ran away years later when his older brother tried to reconcile with him. He ran away. Moses murdered a man, and while leading the children of Israel into the wilderness, he had some serious anger issues. And yet you can't blame him. But he had anger issues so much so to the point where he was kept from going into the promised land with the children of Israel. Rahab was a prostitute before meeting the children of Israel. Samson loved the prostitutes. Jephthah was a son of a prostitute who became a mighty warrior for Israel. He was a judge. And in his overconfidence, he made a rash oath to sacrifice the first thing he laid his eyes on after coming back from a battle. And the first thing he saw was his daughter coming out of his tent to rejoice and celebrate him coming home from war in victory. And then we have David. I don't even have to. Do I even have to talk about David? We all know what David did. Yet they are listed here as examples of enduring faith. So don't read this list and say, I'm not them. All right? We've all had areas of our lives where we lacked in endurance. But thank God for his mercy and his grace, right? We can get back up. So, not only that, as John MacArthur notes, some of these saints listed experienced great success, whereas others suffered great and heavy affliction. The point is that they all endured and followed God regardless of their earthly outcome. I want to repeat that again. Regardless of their earthly outcome. I repeat that because today, and I'm sure this has always been the case, but I'll highlight today, there are many who follow God as a means to earthly outcomes or earthly desires. And that's dangerous. It's not a steady foundation because then there are people who deny God when they don't get their earthly outcome that they would desire. There's a lot of people who fall away, and those earthly desires and outcomes could be good. It could be the healing of a loved one. It could be money to pay the bills. It could be anything. And if those earthly desires don't come into fruition, they fall away. Why? Because they were using God as a means to an end, when God is the end and the beginning and the in-between. But when it comes to the saints of old, looking forward to the promise, consider Job. Now this blew my mind. I've read Joel before, but again, you know how it is when the Lord emphasizes certain things that you've read before. In Job 19, chapter 25, verse 25 to 27, Job said, I know my Redeemer lives, and at the end he will stand on the dust or on the earth. Even after my skin has been destroyed, yet I will see God in my flesh. I will see him myself. My eyes will look at him and not as a stranger. Job is one of the, if not the oldest book in the Bible. And he's talking about seeing God with his eyes. What an example of a saint looking from afar off, right? In Deuteronomy 18, verse 15, Moses, speaking to the children of Israel, he said, the Lord God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you, from your brothers. It is to him you shall listen. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their brothers, and I will put my mouth in his hands, and he shall speak to them all the words that I command him. And whoever will not listen to my words that he shall speak in my name, I myself will require it of him. In Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 33 and 34, God says, I will put my law within them. I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And no longer shall each one teach his neighbor and each his brother, saying, know the Lord, for they shall all know me. From the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity and I will remember their sin no more. This is just a handful of examples here. If we were to go through just half of the examples that's in the Old Testament, we'd be here until sundown. These saints of old, though regarded as heroes of the faith, did not receive the promise and will not receive the promise apart from us. Those of us who endure will receive the same promise together with the saints of old, and that is to be with him, that is to be like him, that is to know him fully. The writer is saying that it is Jesus who is superior to angels, who is better than Moses and the prophets. He's the fulfillment of the high priestly role. He's the creator of all things. He's better than the sacrificial system. In fact, the sacrificial system was pointing to him the entire time. It is Jesus who died for the ungodly, and he is ours. He is our possession. He is the promise. He is the great reward. He is the city. He is the heavenly possession. Our brother David Mengi wrote in the men's group chat that I had to pull this when you wrote it, when you texted. The truth is that endurance does not exist in a vacuum. For endurance to be endurance, it must have a strong and sure foundation, namely the steadfast love of God and his faithfulness. Now get this. We won't endure, we won't hold, we won't stand if we don't trust God's unshakable love for us. If we don't trust God's love for us, we will be swept away. We will. And so Jesus is our peace. He's the anchor of our souls. The fact that Christ died for the ungodly and rose from the dead and now intercedes for his people is our sure foundation. It's proof, again, of his unshakable love for us. And in the same way that he holds all of creation together, he holds our lives together in him right now. Right now. in Hebrews chapter 12. I'm not going to go too much in chapter 12. Joanna's going to touch on that next week. But just the first few verses, it talks about Jesus being the founder and perfecter of our faith, who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross. And it led me to ask the question again, what is the joy set before us? In 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3, he talks about us being born again to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. That's the great reward again. That's the heavenly city again. In Matthew 5, Matthew 5, verse 10, Jesus, when speaking of those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, what does he say? Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. There's the reward again. In Isaiah chapter 25, verses 8 and 9, he wrote about the Lord, he will swallow up death forever, and the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces, and the reproach of his people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, behold, this is our God. We have waited for him that he might save us. This is the Lord. We have waited for him. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. There's a reward again. There's so much more. But all of these are examples of what Peter is talking about as well, where he talks about the prophets who prophesied about the grace that was to come. And they searched and inquired carefully, inquiring when the Spirit of Christ, what was that the Spirit of Christ indicating that he would suffer and bring subsequent glories? And what else did Peter write? It was revealed to them that they were not serving themselves, but you. All of these are just examples of Old Testament prophets looking from afar and seeing what was coming. So as I begin to close, I have to ask myself, I have to ask all of us, what are we enduring for? Ultimately, what are we enduring for? What is the picture that our life is painting? Are we enduring for that which is earthly? Are we enduring for happiness, a good and easy life, financial freedom, comfort, a good career, a good car, popularity, a good reputation, relevance, good health, safety? Are we enduring for our racial tribe, our political tribe? Is it election season? Are we enduring for a certain election outcome? All of these can be good things, but they are all temporary. They all fade. They can be all taken away. They're all perishable. And they do all fade. Even more so, enduring for those things, and there's obviously the list is endless, right? I could add a lot more to the list. But enduring for those things can make us feel right at home, right here. Rather than prompting us to acknowledge that we are strangers and exiles on this earth. You know, I could remember listening to a sermon. This is years ago, very early in my walk. I was listening to a sermon, and it was either John Piper or Paul Washer. And whoever it was, I heard him say that America is one of the hardest places to be a Christian. And I remember thinking, what? How? What is he talking about? How can America be one of the hardest places to be a Christian? We got freedom of religion here, right? We got freedom of speech. I can say I'm a Christian, right? We're not persecuted by our government, right? That's debatable now, right? It wasn't until years later that I understood that with all its modernity, it is extremely easy to be caught up in the comfort of this world here. The convenience of it. It makes it that much harder to do as was written of Moses that we read earlier when he considered again the reproach of Christ's greater wealth than the treasures of Egypt. Are we willing to consider the reproach of Christ's greater wealth than the riches of America or Europe or wherever you are, wherever we are? Again, Hebrews 11, verses 13, it said that all these, again, I'm repeating the theme. All these died in faith, having not received the things promised, but having seen them and greeted them from afar, and having acknowledged that they were strangers and exiles on the earth. The CBS version states it as acknowledging that they were foreigners and temporary residents on the earth. You see, the writer of Hebrews is calling his audience, and I believe the Holy Spirit is calling us, to stay connected to this legacy of enduring. This legacy of enduring belief. And it is applicable to us today, as we are called to continue in this race, because that, when we read that list, that is our spiritual legacy as well. When we read, when we're praying for a persecuted church, that is our spiritual legacy as well. We prayed for the Mormons. When Mormons leave the Mormonism faith and they acknowledge Jesus as he truly is, they are shunned by their family. They lose everything. That's our spiritual legacy. And it's not just Mormonism, obviously, we know. It's the same thing with Islam. Same thing with other religions. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4. It states, but God, being rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together, again, together in Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised up with him, and he seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show his immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. There's the reward again. That is the goal. That is being made perfect. It's not just that we are forgiven. It's not just that we have an open channel to God. That's great. But what's even better is that God sees us as he sees his son. It is that he is well pleased with us, not because of what we've done, but because of what Christ did and is continuing to do for us right now. It's that he delights in us. That's the great reward. It's that our home is now at his side. He made room for us there in his blood. And guess what? If he made room for us with his blood, that means that placement is permanent. Because nothing is going to wash away the blood of the Lamb. That placement is permanent there. And in the new heaven and in the new earth, all of that will be fully manifested. That is the reward. And it is then that the saints of old, along with all of us, will be made perfect together. Then we shall see him face to face. Then we will see him with our own eyes, as Job wrote. Imagine that. You will see him with your own eyes, not as our judge, but as our king, as our savior, as our redeemer, as our brother, as our friend. Again, Isaiah chapter 25, he will swallow up death forever. He will wipe away tears from all faces. The reproach of his people will be taken away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken, it will be said on that day, behold, I could just imagine seeing him and saying this, behold, this is our God. We have waited for him that he might save us. This is the Lord. We have waited for him. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. And I'll end it with this. The late R.C. Sproul says the result of reconciliation. This is, all right, this is a hard one, okay? I'm just prepping you right now. It's hard. It's really good news, but it is hard because there's a call to action there, okay? He says the result of reconciliation is unspeakable joy. The Christian life from beginning to end is meant to be a life of joy. There's no room for a sourpuss in the kingdom of God. There's nothing dour about our redemption. If we suffer, here we go. If we suffer to a degree that nobody else has ever been called to suffer, a modern-day Job sitting on a dung heap, we would have no right to say anything different from what Job said. Though he slay me, yet I will trust him. No affliction so dour, no sorrow so deep, no pain so intense is worthy to be compared to the glory that we have received in the beloved reconciliation. So contemplate our state of affairs in the world. We see our bank accounts slipping away. We see our homes, some homes are destroyed. Our jobs lost. Our bodies are torn by disease. And we have every reason to complain, whine, and weep. But if we lift our eyes for 1 second to the cross and the resurrection, we see that the Lord God, who should be too holy to even look at us, now looks at us and embraces us and adopts us as his children because we have been reconciled to him. That's what we're pressing towards. So I hope that this has been an encouragement to you to press on. I know I got some pressing on to do after doing this. You know, because that's what we're enduring for. And there is no other worldview. There's no other religion. that offers anything remotely like this. Everything fails in comparison to what Christ has bought us, in comparison to him. It's like comparing a flashlight with dead batteries to the sun. So that's what we're enduring for. Jesus is the better reward. And may our lives reflect that. That's what I have. Thanks.
Thanks. Thanks. Amen. Thank you, Jonathan. Thank you. I'm a little jealous because I really wanted to preach that passage, but I couldn't have handled it any better than you did. So thank you, and thank God for you. You know, the one thing, one of the things, and there's a lot of them, but one of the things that Jonathan said that I really want us to grab, and Hebrews does this over and over again, right? You are God's house if, you know, there's ifs that keeps going, and the if is always connected to endurance, and the if is always connected to the end. But one of the points that Jonathan made, I just want to emphasize as we close tonight, and that is that enduring faith isn't perfect, but it's enduring faith that perfects us. We don't have to be perfect to endure, but if we will endure, we will be perfect. And so it is really, truly this profound. I don't want to say simple. Don't let go, and you will be everything. Not just that you were meant to be. We will be everything that Jesus is. Would you stand with me tonight? Father, we thank you tonight for your word. We thank you for your servant who is our brother. We thank you for your spirit who lives in us. We thank you that you are the great reward. Thank you that you give good gifts all along the way, but none of those gifts are the reward. Thank you that you provide things for us, but none of those things are the promise. Thank you that you gave Isaac to Abraham, and your word says, but he died without the promise. Thank you that you brought Moses out of Egypt, but the word says that he died without receiving his promise. Thank you that there is a greater promise for all of us. And so tonight, may we endure what we would rather not go through so we can get to where we really don't belong. May we endure difficulty. May we endure what we would call lack. May we endure seasons that we don't look forward to or did not enjoy or even don't think we deserve. May we endure all of them because there is a city we don't belong in that has been established for us. There is a seat at a table we don't deserve to sit at that has been reserved for us. There is a father who has adopted his enemies and called them his children. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, that it was the joy that was set before you that you clung to when you went to the cross. I pray tonight that you would begin to do a work in every one of us, that the cross would be the joy set before us. That we would despise whatever reproach that this life brings, because the joy of the cross is always greater. Thank you, Jesus, that you are our great reward. May we count you worthy of a life spent on you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Real briefly tonight, I just want to close with a benediction from 2 Corinthians chapter 1. As you already know, it's not really a benediction, but we're going to use it. For all the promises of God find their yes in him. That is why it is through him that we utter our amen to God for his glory. And it is God who establishes us with you in Christ and has anointed us and who has also put his seal on us and given us his spirit in our hearts as a guarantee. God bless you guys.